Bertha Morisot, Bertha Marie Pauline Morisot, January 14, 1841, March 2, 1895, was a painter and a member of the circle of painters in Paris who became known as the Impressionists. She was described by Gustave Geffroy in 1894 as one of les trois grandes dames of Impressionism alongside Marie Bracamond and Mary Cassatt. In 1864, she exhibited for the first time in the highly esteemed Salon de Paris. Sponsored by the government and judged by academicians, the Salon was the official, annual exhibition of the Académie des Beaux-Arts in Paris. Her work was selected for exhibition in six subsequent salons until, in 1874, she joined the rejected Impressionists in the first of their own exhibitions, which included Paul Cézanne, Edgar Degas, Claude Monet, Camille Pissarro, Pierre-Auguste Renoir and Alfred Sisley. It was held at the studio of the photographer Nadar. She was married to Eugène Manet, the brother of her friend and colleague Édouard Manet. Morisot was born in Bourges, France, into an affluent bourgeois family. Her father, Edmond-Imbert Morisot, was the prefect, senior administrator, of the Department of Cher. He also studied architecture at École des Beaux-Arts. Her mother, Marie-Josephine Cornélie Thomas, was the great-niece of Jean-Honoré Fragonard, one of the most prolific Rococo painters of the Ancien Régime. She had two older sisters, Eve, 1838-1893, and Edma, 1839-1921, plus a younger brother, Tibers, born in 1848. The family moved to Paris in 1852, when Morisot was a child. It was commonplace for daughters of bourgeois families to receive art education, so Bertha and her sisters Eve and Edma were taught privately by Geoffroy Alphonse Chacarne and Morisot and her sisters initially started taking lessons so that they could each make a drawing for their father for his birthday. In 1857, Guichard, who ran a school for girls in Rue des Moulins, introduced Bertha and Edma to the Louvre Gallery where they could learn by looking, and from 1858 they learned by copying paintings. The Morisots were not only forbidden to work at the museum unchaperoned, but they were also totally barred from formal training. However, the museum served another key purpose, because it enabled them to get acquainted with young male artists, such as Manet and Monet. He also introduced them to the works of Cavarni. Guichard later became the director of École des Beaux-Arts where Morisot's father earned his degree. In 1861 Guichard introduced Bertha to Jean-Baptiste Camille Corot, a French painter, who influenced her early landscapes. As art students, Bertha and Edma worked closely together until 1869, when Edma married Adolphe Pontillon, a naval officer, moved to Cherbourg and had less time to paint. Letters between the sisters show a loving relationship, underscored by Bertha's regret at the distance between them and Edma's withdrawal from painting. Edma wholeheartedly supported Bertha's continued work and their families always remained close. Edma wrote, "I am often with you in thought, dear Bertha. I'm in your studio and I like to slip away, if only for a quarter of an hour, to breathe that atmosphere that we shared for many years." Her sister Eve married Theodore Gaubiard, a tax inspector, in 1866 and was painted by Edgar Degas as Mrs. Theodore Gaubiard, Metropolitan Museum of Art, New York. Morisot registered as a copyist at the Louvre where she befriended other artists and teachers including Camille Corot, the pivotal landscape painter of the Barbizon School who also excelled in figure painting. In 1860, under Corot's influence she took up the plein air, outdoors, method of working. By 1863 she was studying under another Barbizon painter. In the winter of 1863-64 she studied sculpture under Aimé Millet, but none of her sculpture is known to survive. It is hard to trace the stages of Morisot's training and to tell the exact influence of her teachers because she was never pleased with her work and she destroyed nearly all of the artworks she produced before 1869. Her first teacher, Geoffroy Alphonse Chacarne, taught her the basics of drawing. After several months, Morisot began to take classes taught by Joseph Guichard. During this period, she found her talents in drawing and drew mostly ancient classical figures. When Morisot expressed her interest in plein air painting, Guichard sent her to follow Camille Corot and Achille Oudinot. Painting outdoor, she played with the light and time with the use of watercolors which are easy to carry. At that time, Morisot also became interested in pastel. During this period, she practiced watercolors for most of the time. Her choice of colors is rather restrained, however, the delicate repetition of hues renders a balanced effect. Due to specific characteristics of watercolors as a medium, Morisot was able to create a translucent atmosphere and feathery touch, which contribute to the freshness in her paintings. In fact, between 1870 to 1873, Morisot still found oil painting difficult and she could only apply her watercolor works to the oil paintings. During this time, Morisot felt more confident about oil painting, and she would paint in oil, watercolor and pastel at the same time, as Degas did. Morisot painted very quickly but she also prepared a lot in advance. Firstly, she made countless studies of her subject matter. Her subjects were repeatedly drawn from her life so she became quite familiar with them. Morisot did much sketching as preparation, so she could paint a mouth, eyes, and a nose with a single brushstroke. Secondly, when it became inconvenient to paint outdoors, the very highly finished watercolors done in preparatory stages allowed her to continue painting indoors later. Since 1885, drawing began to dominate in Morisot's works. Morisot actively experimented with charcoals and color pencils. What seems paradoxical is that her reviving interest in drawing was motivated by her impressionist friends, who are known for blurring forms. Morisot put her emphasis on the clarification of the form and lines during this period. In addition, she was under the influence of developing technology of photography and Japonism, shown in her composition without a clear center. Morisot started to use the technique of squaring in the medium of tracing paper to transcribe her drawing to the canvas exactly. By employing this new method, Morisot was able to create brand new types of compositions where more complicated interaction between figures in the paintings and the numerous adjustments emerged. She stressed the composition and the forms while her impressionist brushstrokes still remained. Her original synthesis of the impressionist touch with broad strokes and light reflections and the graphic approach featured by clear lines made her late works really distinctive. Morisot's paintings are commented as full of feminine charm, which features elegance and lightness. Her brushstrokes are as light as the touch of a petal, therefore, French critics often use the verb effleurer, to touch lightly, brush against, to describe her technique. In her early life, Morisot painted in open air as other impressionists to look for truths in observation. Around 1880 she began painting on unprimed canvases, a technique Manet and Eva Gonzalez also experimented with at the time, and her brushwork became looser. In 1888-89, her brushstrokes transitioned from short, rapid strokes to long, sinuous ones that define form. The outer edges of her paintings were often left unfinished, allowing the canvas to show through and increasing the sense of spontaneity. After 1885, she worked mostly from preliminary drawings before beginning her oil paintings. She also worked in oil paint, watercolors, and pastel simultaneously, and sketched using various drawing media. Morisot's works are almost always small in scale. Morisot creates a sense of space and depth through the use of color. Although her color palette was somehow limited, her fellow impressionists regarded her as a virtuoso colorist. She typically made expansive use of white to create a sense of transparency, whether used as a pure white or mixed with other colors. In her large painting, The Cherry Tree, colors are more vivid but are still used to emphasize form. Furthermore, it is no wonder that the style and techniques that Morisot applied were greatly inspired by her impressionist friends. Inspired by Manet's drawings, she kept the use of colors to the minimum when constructing a motif. Responding to the experiments conducted by Edouard Manet and Edgar Degas, Morisot used barely tinted whites to harmonize the paintings. Like Degas, she played with three media simultaneously in one painting: watercolor, pastel, and oil paints. In the second half of her career, she learned from Renoir by mimicking his motifs. She also shared an interest in keeping a balance between the density of figures and the atmospheric traits of light with Renoir in her later works. Morisot painted what she experienced on a daily basis. Most of her paintings include domestic scenes about family, children, ladies, and flowers, depicting what women's life was like in the late 19th century. Instead of portraying the public space and the society, Morisot preferred private, intimate scenes. It somehow reflects the cultural restrictions of her class and gender at that time. Like her fellow impressionist Mary Cassatt, she focused on domestic life and portraits in which she could use family and personal friends as models, including her daughter Julie and sister Edma. The stenographic presentation of her daily life conveys a strong hope to stop the fleeting passage of time. By portraying flowers, she used metaphors to celebrate womanhood. Prior to the 1860s, Morisot painted subjects in line with the Barbizon school before turning to scenes of contemporary femininity. Paintings like The Cradle, 1872, in which she depicted current trends for nursery furniture, reflect her sensitivity to fashion and advertising, both of which would have been apparent to her female audience. Her works also include landscapes, garden settings, boating scenes, and theme of boredom or ennui. Later in her career, Morisot worked with more ambitious themes, such as nudes. In her late works, she often referred to the past to recall the memory of her earlier life and youth, and her departed companions. Morisot's first appearance in the Salon de Paris came at the age of 23 in 1864, with the acceptance of two landscape paintings. She continued to show regularly in the Salon, to generally favorable reviews, until 1873, the year before the first Impressionist exhibition. She exhibited with the Impressionists from 1874 onwards, only missing the exhibition in 1878 when her daughter was born. Impressionism's alleged attachment to brilliant color, sensual surface effects, and fleeting sensory perceptions led a number of critics to assert in retrospect that this style, once primarily the battlefield of insouciant, combative males, was inherently feminine and best suited to women's weaker temperaments, lesser intellectual capabilities, and greater sensibility. During her 1874 exhibition with the Impressionists, such as Monet and Manet, Le Figaro critic Albert Wolff noted that the Impressionists consisted of five or six lunatics, of which one is a woman whose feminine grace is maintained amid the outpourings of a delirious mind. Morisot's mature career began in 1872. She found an audience for her work with Durand Ruel, the private dealer, who bought 22 paintings. In 1877, she was described by the critic for L'Attempts as the one real Impressionist in this group. She chose to exhibit under her full maiden name instead of using a pseudonym or her married name. As her skill and style improved, many began to rethink their opinion toward Morisot. In the 1880 exhibition, many reviews judged Morisot among the best, even including Le Figaro critic Albert Wolff. Morisot came from an eminent family, the daughter of a government official and the granddaughter of a famous Rococo artist Jean-Honoré Fragonard. She met her longtime friend and colleague, Edouard Manet, in 1868. By the introduction of Manet, Morisot was married to Edouard's brother, Eugène Manet, in 1874. In 1878 she gave birth to her only child, Julie, who posed frequently for her mother and other Impressionist artists, including Renoir and her uncle Edouard. Morisot had a close relationship with Edouard Manet, who exerted a tremendous influence on her. Correspondence between them shows warm affection, and Manet gave her an easel as a Christmas present. Morisot often posed for Manet, and there are several portrait paintings of Morisot, such as Repose, Portrait of Bertha Morisot, and Bertha Morisot with a Bouquet. Morisot died on March 2, 1895, in Paris, of pneumonia contracted while attending to her daughter Julie's similar illness, and thus making her an orphan at the age of 16. She was interred in the Cimetière de Passy. This limited selection is based in part on a book, Bertha Morisot, by Charles F. Stuckey, William P. Scott, and Susan G. Lindsay, which is in turn drawn from the 1961 catalogue by Marie-Louise Bataille, Ruth Dennis, and Georges Wildenstein. There are variations between the dates of execution, first showing and purchase. Titles may vary between sources. Morisot's work sold comparatively well. She achieved the two highest prices at a Hotel Drouot auction in 1875. The Interior, Young Woman with Mirror, sold for 480 francs, and her Pastel on the Lawn sold for 320 francs. Her works averaged 250 francs, the best relative prices at the auction. In February 2013, Morisot became the highest-priced female artist, when After Lunch, 1881, a portrait of a young redhead in a straw hat and purple dress, sold for $10.9 million at a Christie's auction. The painting achieved roughly three times its upper estimate, exceeding the $10.7 million for a sculpture by Louise Bourgeois in 2012. She was portrayed by actress Marine Deltermi in a 2012 French biographical TV film directed by Caroline Champetier. The character of Beatrice de Clerval in Elizabeth Kostova's The Swan Thieves is largely based on Morisot. She was featured as the first Impressionist in an article written by Anne Truitt in the New York Times on June 3, 1990. From Melissa Burdick Harmon, a editor at Biography magazine, while some of Morisot's work may seem to us today like sweet depictions of babies in cradles, at the time these images were considered extremely intimate, as objects related to infants belonged exclusively to the world of women. Thanks for watching. Don't forget like the video and don't forget to subscribe.